Stephen Foster, who will be guiding you safely home, we trust, in his Drive Time programme today. Previous on the programme, we're chatting to Dr. John Ashdown. He's a former Suffolk teacher whose archaeological research was absolutely essential in locating the remains of Richard III, who, as you know, was found in a Leicester car park in 2012. I think I might have said your name wrong then, Dr. Ashdown Hill. I apologise for that. Now, what we're after was knowing what the very latest is, but as you said there, this is quite a tale to tell.
Yes, well, the first thing is to make sure you can hear me this time, Georgina.
Yes, I don't know why, isn't it?
Because I was talking merrily away to myself before, but obviously it wasn't getting over to you. Yeah, the story's been a long one. I mean, the original agreement between the Looking for Richard project team, of which I was one of the founder members, and ULAS, the archaeological service in Leicester, was that as soon as the scientific work was over, the body, the remains, once they'd been identified, would be removed from the University of Leicester and taken to a religious house. We had in mind Mount St. Bernard's Abbey just outside Leicester. So the extraordinary thing is that although the identification was confirmed very publicly last February, actually Richard III is still in a box in Leicester University, and until recently apparently he was sitting under a table with an old kettle on top of him, which sounds a little bit disrespectful to me. But I'm trying at the moment to have a funeral crown made for him, so he'll have something a bit more respectful to lie on his coffin when he does eventually get reburied.
Oh, well, tell us about the crown then.
Well, the crown, it occurred to me when I was carrying the remains, I'd taken with me, as one does, a royal standard just in case, and so I was able to put that over the cardboard box when I was carrying it from the excavation site. But it occurred to me as I was carrying it there was probably something missing that one would normally see at a royal funeral, and so I started talking to a jeweller who reproduces medieval jewellery. He'd never made a crown before, but we've had a very interesting discussion about it, and taken some inspiration from a surviving crown of Richard III's sister, which is in Germany now at Aachen Cathedral, Margaret of York. Her beautiful little crown has got all the jewels set on enamelled white roses, so we decided we'd do the same for Richard III.
So is a funeral crown different from another crown?
Or yes. Funeral crowns are usually not made of solid gold, because they're not going to be worn by anybody. They're just carried on coffins, and sometimes in the past were actually buried with people. So they're normally made of base metal, gilded, and set with jewels. And that's fortunate for me because it makes it a little bit less expensive.
Yeah. And where's the jeweller who's making it?
Well, he works actually in Sussex.
Okay. And so it's the first one of that type that he's made. I mentioned it.
He's made some beautiful reproductions of pieces of medieval jewellery, but he said to me, it was the first thing he said when we talked about it, that he'd never ever made a crown before.
Is there anything else that he would have been buried with?
If he'd been buried as kings normally were in those days, probably he would have been buried with a set of funeral regalia. So he would probably have had a sceptre as well, and a royal robe. The situation for the reburial is a bit odd. In fact, there's some negotiation and argument going on about that, because some people like me think that his bones should be laid out anatomically, as the as is done, for example, nowadays with soldiers' bodies when they're discovered and brought home for reburial. But there are other people, including Leicester Cathedral, who think that he should be packed in a little ossuary box, which I think is a little bit less respectful. So I hope there'll be more discussion about that.
I suppose it's difficult to know who gets the final word with this, because it's very uncharted territory, isn't it?
It's a unique situation, and I think one of the unfortunate things is that there hasn't really been very open discussion about some of the things. Lots of people have opinions. Obviously, you can't satisfy everybody, whatever you do. But I think it would be politic and tactful to take on board what people are saying, and I'm rather hoping that the judicial review in London, the next hearing of which is in March, I'm rather hoping that that might, in the end, set up some sort of body to adjudicate questions like this, so the decisions are taken out of the hands of individuals, because I think that's a mistake.
Because he has still got some descendants, hasn't he?
Well, he hasn't actually got descendants, but he's got collateral descendants. That's to say, they're descendants of his brothers and sisters. Richard III doesn't have any descendants, but one of his sisters and two of his brothers have living descendants, and that's it's some of those who have set up the case that's going on in the law courts, and the next hearing will be in March.
Oh, it's going to go, it rumbles on and on, doesn't it?
It does, yes. I think it's a bit surprising. I don't think we would have expected, I and other members of the Looking for Richard Project, when we first set this up, I don't think we would have expected that it would have taken quite this long. But
Now, as well as playing a key role in the identity of discovering the identity of Richard III's remains, you had a big part to play in this banner from Bosworth, is that right? Were you part of the people who identified that?
Well, it's a curious story. I mean, we can't absolutely identify it, but it, as a result of the fact that my name became known through the discovery of Richard III's remains, I was contacted by some people who live about 10 miles away from me, and they told me that they had a banner which was labelled as, or part of a banner, which was labelled as being from the Battle of Bosworth and having belonged to Richard III's army. Not Richard III personally, but his army. They asked me if I would have a look at it and try to help to identify it. And I did take a look at it, and so also did some medieval cloth experts. We did in the end conclude that it's of roughly the right date and the right sort of design, but it's absolutely impossible at this distance in time to authenticate it completely. But the people who owned it have put it up for sale. It's going on sale in Martlesham in February. If anybody wants to buy a Richard III banner, there's the opportunity.
How much do they think it might make?
Well, something similar. There are actually several other examples, and this one looks very much like the others that are in existence. One was sold last September for, I think it brought in about £3,500.
That's not bad. Not bad. So Bosworth, just to remind us, this was the horse, a horse, my kingdom, a horse, where Richard III was killed.
That'll, yes.
And that's the end of the Tudors. Well, what would the banners have served the purpose of? Just to make sure you knew who was where on the battlefield?
Yes, it was a way of collecting your soldiers together. You wanted something visible, sort of stuck up on a pole so that people could see where you were.
Okay, how big is the banner? Is it a scrap of it, or is it the whole thing?
Oh no, this particular one, the one that was sold last September, was the piece was fairly small, but this is quite a large, substantial piece. I would say it's something like between 2 and 3 feet in length.
Well, was that quite a prestigious position then, to carry the banner? Would that have been one of it? Who would have done that?
If you were carrying the royal banner, so the king's own banner, yes, that was a prestigious position. But rather as in warfare, not just in the Middle Ages, but in much more recent times, it would just have been a duty assigned to a soldier. In a way, it was a bit of a dangerous position, because of course if you were carrying something large and noticeable, people could see, the enemy could see you as well. Bearers of banners did sometimes suffer unfortunate fate.
And another lovely bit of news is that you yourself, Dr. Ash Downhill, you're going to get an honorary degree from the University of Essex, which is lovely to know.
Well, yes, I had a rather surprising letter. I could see that it was from the University of Essex, and I had to sign for it. I thought, whatever is this? And yes, it was, I received it just before Christmas, and I do already have several degrees, but it really is very touching that they should want to honour me in that way. And I do have a sort of ongoing connection with the University in Colchester, the University of Essex, because use its library quite often, and they have sometimes asked me to give lectures there. But to have them recognise all the work I've done in this way was really very nice.
Well, it's, congratulations from us too. I'm sure you'll get one from Suffolk as well. Lovely to speak to you as ever. What are you working on at the moment? Is it Richard III or is it another project you've got?
Well, since the Richard III work, I spent quite a lot of time underground last year in Tewkesbury Abbey looking at remains that might be Richard III's brother, the Duke of Clarence. And I have a book on him and the work that I did on those remains coming out in about 4 weeks' time. And just before Christmas, my publishers sent me all the proofs to read and to do the indexing of, which is really a very boring job, actually, doing the indexing.
Over Christmas, that's what
it's been. It wasn't a very festive season.
Well, you have to come back and tell us all about that. That all sounds wonderful.
Thank you.
Lovely. Thanks ever so much. Our guest there. Dr.